What's up, you guys? Shout out to here in Singapore. As always, thank you so much for joining in. You guys already know what I usually do is channel whatever message is coming to me based on the things that I've seen, heard, or absorbed, or read, any of those things. So I listen to podcasts. I read posts all day long. I try to do a lot of research because I am in a growth mode. I really want to learn more about the world around me and see if I can make connections for you guys that maybe will help your perspective, help your understanding of the world around you. So more than anything else, I love talking about my feelings. I love talking about the way we understand each other, the way we communicate, the pain that we don't talk about, because there's a lot of healing that's sitting behind that pain if we can just sit and listen to it. So today I really want to talk about the fact that we need to make it a habit to listen to what hurts, because when something hurts us, we have an opportunity to see, you know, why it hurts us. What is it that it's telling us? What is it that we are assigning the value to it as in, like, if something somebody does to me kind of makes me feel jealous all of a sudden, what does that mean? Me feeling jealous means that I've already assumed that the other person they're talking about is better than I am. And what is it about them that makes them better than me? Is it something physical that I can't change? Is it the fact that they have a figure that I don't have? Or is it their nose is different, or they are a different race? What is it that I am comparing myself to, which is actually unfair to me? So these are the things that I actually really think are very important. So when I say listen to what hurts, I mean pay attention. When something pops up, when something makes you feel sad, perhaps, why is it that you feel sad? Is it that you suddenly feel a lack, that you don't have what you would like to have, and suddenly you feel sad because it's not there? Or maybe you had it once and it's no longer there, and you feel sad over the loss of something. Perhaps it's someone who passed away or someone who walked away. Those are two very different feelings. I've had podcast episodes about that as well. The fact that if somebody were to walk away, they still exist somewhere in the world, but they're choosing specifically not to be around you or to engage with you, and that can be very, very damaging if you continue to focus on it. Whereas if someone were to pass away, no one has access to them anymore, not even you, and so you have just the memories that you lived with, that you can kind of to reach out for and lean on in times of need, because that's all you have left. So there are a great many things that you can actually learn from your emotions, and that's part of the reason that I feel like emotional intelligence is one of those big, magical things that can really help you find balance in your life if you just know how to listen to them. So when I say that you should listen, I mean that you need to let it speak to you, and so you can understand where it's coming from. What is it, the belief that it's like grating on, that makes you feel like it doesn't fit in your world anymore, or you don't fit in the world because of it? So many things. I remember for a very long time, I felt very guilty about the fact that I thought ill of somebody who had actually abused me, because they were a person of authority, a person who was respected and an elder in my family. And I felt like even though they did something that I know was wrong, I don't think it was appropriate, I don't think they had my permission, I don't remember them asking me for the permission, but it left me feeling very ugly and disgusted with myself. And because of that feeling, I tended to avoid them. But when I avoided them, obviously other people could notice the fact that I was purposely avoiding them, and they would call me out on it. So when they did that, I felt like, oh my gosh, you know, yeah, this is a very esteemed person, respectable elder in our family, and here I am treating them like they mean nothing to me, because on the whole, they didn't mean anything to me. But on the outside, people looking in, they could tell that I was being rude or disrespectful. And while I thought I had every right, I had to change my behavior so that people wouldn't call me out on it, because I wasn't in a position to be able to, like, admit the truth or tell anybody what was going on either. So that was a shame thing that I was going through. But now when I look at it, and I've since, 30 years since the event itself, have finally been able to rectify the situation to a point where I don't feel uncomfortable every time that person pops up. I've been able to at least sit with the pain, the shame, understand that, you know what, I felt like I was not meant to disrespect them. I wasn't allowed to, because that was wrong because of their stature, their status in my family. And because I was able to sit down and look at myself and why I felt the way that I did, I understood that from my context, my experience, that I was justified and it was okay. I can't change the way things happened. I can't change the way it left me feeling, but I can choose who I spend my time with, who I associate with, who I am around, because that is my way of protecting myself. If I were to continue associating with chaos all the time, or people who invite drama all the time, that means I'm inviting drama into my own life. And if I'm inviting, which means I have a choice in the matter, that means I have a choice to reject the invitation or decline the invitation as well. Same thing with arguments. If somebody has ever tried to goad you into an argument, trying to, bait you into arguing with them about something, and arguing normally means that you're trying to debate whether or not they're right or whether you're right. That's an argument. Discussion, completely different, right? You can discuss your ideas, I discuss my ideas, and never the twain shall meet, and that's still okay. But when we have an argument, I know that a lot of times I have a choice. Like, I can feel it coming on that somebody's trying really hard to make me feel badly because maybe they feel badly and they feel like maybe if they can get someone else to feel just as badly as they do, they will feel a little bit better about themselves. So it's an energy exchange, not the nicest or most pleasant, obviously. It's more energy vampire, but it happens. But knowing that I have a choice and knowing that because I have a choice, I can really filter through what they're saying and figure out, okay, what exactly are they trying to get accomplished here? Are they trying to make me feel bad? Are they trying to teach me that I did something that hurt them? Are they just picking at things because they feel like shit? Like, what exactly is going on? And so, in that regard, I have this opportunity suddenly to listen to what hurts, to understand why it hurts, and then to figure out if that's something that I can adjust so it doesn't hurt me anymore, as in remove myself from the situation, adjust my understanding of the situation, update my beliefs because maybe they don't fit my life anymore, like any one of a million things, and maybe I can find a little bit of peace so that my emotions don't rule. Because the immature version of me would have sat with the emotion and obsessed about the fact that this person did this to me instead of understanding why it bothered me so much. I've done plenty of episodes about relationships and times where me and my friends have some kind of a disagreement and I went away feeling like they were against me or they did something to me, only to sit down and let it settle and realize later on that they didn't do it to me, but it did affect me. And now I need to figure out why it affected me so much. What was it that I was expecting that I didn't get? What was it that I thought that I could count on that didn't happen? What was it that they promised that they went back on? Any of those things. But those are my expectations that are hurting me, not something that they did. So as much as people can say that they'll stick around, they'll be there or whatever, it's all about their intentions. It's all about their actions. And a lot of times, if you just let them be, you can tell who they really are. But bottom line is, I think it's more important for us all to learn to listen to what actually hurts us, as in to when it hurts us, right? You look at the emotion itself, name that emotion. What is it? Is it anger? Is it hatred? Is it jealousy? Is it, what is the word I want to use here? Disgust? Is it shame? Is it guilt? Is it sadness? Any one of those things. Once you name it, then you can figure out, okay, well, what is it about this thing that makes me feel this way? Why is it that I feel like I need to compare myself to other women because I want a specific person's attention? Or why is it that I feel like, my mom is favoriting, has favoritism towards one sibling versus another, and I feel left out? Or why is it my daughter prefers one person over another? Like, all of these things mean something to me. It is my view of the world, my perception. And if I can just sit there for a moment and think about why it is that I feel that way, what is it that I'm telling myself is the reason behind it? And is that something that I can control? If it's something that someone else's perspective, the best I can do is go to the source and ask for why or what the explanation is. But bottom line is, if they happen to come up with an explanation I don't like, what am I going to do then, right? I need to still adjust my perspective, which means upgrade my beliefs, which means sit and think about what it is that I'm telling myself is the meaning of all of this. Because I get to choose the meaning of all of this. I can choose if it's meaningless. I can choose if, it's something that's really, really important and I need to deal with it right now. It's urgent. So all of those things means that whenever my emotions pop up, I make note of it. And that includes the good emotions. That includes the joy and the love and the affection and the camaraderie. All of those things make sense too, because when you listen to those emotions, you get to learn more about what makes you happy. You get to write down all the things that, the little things that brightened your day. Maybe it was the way the sun broke through the clouds just after the rain, or maybe the smell of grass after it's been cut. Something as simple as finding a couple extra dollars in a seat cushion because you didn't think you had any money and you just suddenly found some. Just little things like that that make you really feel good are just as important as the ones that don't make you feel so great. So if you have a chance, I would love to hear your feedback. Let me know what you think, but I really want to encourage and foster this environment where we learn to listen to what hurts and understand what it is that is teaching us about ourselves. Because the more self-aware we are, the less likely we are to be bullied by our emotions, the less likely we are to be stuck in any one feeling. We know what to do to get out of it or what to do to change or transmute the kind of dark feelings that kind of creep up sometimes. So I hope that makes sense. If you got any questions, drop me a line. But in the meantime, remember, your emotions are super, super helpful and very, very informative if you just take the time to listen. I'll catch you later. Bye.